Hello friends, welcome all of you. Myself Dr. Kirti Sriram Kulkarni from Gokhale Education Society's Arts, Commerce and Science College, Chavar. Here we are learning SYBSC Chemistry Paper 3 and we have already started the first unit, that is Introduction to Analytical Chemistry and Statistical Treatment of Analytical Data. So in the last lecture, we have already seen about the importance of analytical chemistry and chemical analysis. So in last lecture, we have already discussed about what are the different objectives of analytical chemistry and what is the meaning of chemical analysis. So what are the different terms involved in chemical analysis are error, accuracy, precision and reproducibility that we have already discussed in our last lecture. So today we will see the next part of this. So the next definition is selectivity. Before starting this, I would like to say that all these terms we are learning in terms of chemical analysis and analytical chemistry. That means to find out quality and quantity of sample, we are applying different method of chemical analysis. And these different terms are explaining the characteristic of the methods. Means whatever experiment you are carrying out, these are called as methods. And these methods are giving this particular properties. So already four properties we have discussed and now we will see the fifth property of the method that we are applying in analysis. So what is selectivity? It is a method which is defined as the degree to which the method is free from interference present in the matrix. What is the meaning of this? Whenever you apply a particular method, that method can be specific to that particular component and it should be different from the matrix, meaning it should not give any background effect. So selectivity of a method means your method should be very selective for the sample that you are using for the analysis. It should not have any interference for the matrix. What is the meaning of matrix? That means the solution in which your component is present, that is called as matrix. So selectivity will give you idea about the method which is selective for only required component and it should not have any interference regarding the matrix in which our sample or our component is present. Next is sensitivity. Sensitivity of any analytical method is measure of ability of the method to discriminate between two small concentration difference in the analyte. In a simple language, we can say that sensitivity interprets or detects the ability of the sample. It can be also defined as for a given concentration, it is the slope of the calibration curve at the given particular concentration. For example, we can say that a person is very sensitive, means he will react for a situation very easily. Whether it can be happy situation or it can be a sad situation, a sensitive person will give immediate effect or immediate reaction. Similarly, the method which you are applying is sensitive for that particular small amount of concentration present in our sample. So, we can say that it is the lowest analyte concentration that can be measured with acceptable accuracy and precision. Means while measuring the lowest concentration, the accuracy and the precision also should be maintained. The next definition is limit of detection. So the word itself will suggest you what is the meaning of this limit. So we have also limit of something, whatever work we are performing or now you are listening my video, or anytime you start studying, but after some limit you get exhausted. So similarly, what is the limit of detection? Means up to what concentration or up to what amount a particular method can find out a concentration in our given sample. So what is the definition? It can be defined as minimum amount or the concentration of the component that can be detected with given degree of confidence. Now what is degree of confidence? That we will see in the later part of our chapter, but it should be given with particular amount of confidence, and it is the minimum amount of concentration where our method can find out the detection. So in simple language, the limit of detection is usually defined as the lowest quantity or concentration of a component that can be reliably detected with a given analytical method. So what is the formula for that? It is SM is equal to SB plus 3S. So what is SB? It is the mean blank signal. Now what is blank signal? So before you start your experiment, you have to run the simple solvent that you are using for your experiment, and whatever signal or the instrumental response you get for the particular solvent is called as mean blank signal. And what is S? S is standard deviation for the procedure. Okay, so now SM will give you the limit of detection, which is equal to mean blank signal plus 3 times of your standard deviation. Next definition is limit of quantification. So it is also quite simple. It is the minimum amount of concentration that can be estimated with the given degree of confidence is called as limit of quantification. So now we will head to the next part of the chapter, that is purpose of chemical analysis. So up till now we have seen that what is the different objective of chemical analysis, then what is their importance. Now we will see what is their actual purpose. So it provides you the information about the sample and ultimately about the universe. So as I said that for a particular universe, you have to select your sample very carefully. So the chemical analysis in general could be classified as follows. So first of all, the chemical analysis can be classified based upon nature of information required from the sample. Now what is the meaning of this? From a particular sample, what you want actually? Okay, whether you want to find out the component of that particular sample, its content, etc. So that is called as nature of information that you required from that particular sample. And the second is size of sample material. So both are very important. Now what is size of sample material? Suppose you are analyzing very rare species of some plant or some particular metal, etc. So here you required very small amount of sample, and therefore the chemical analysis is classified into two types based upon nature of information you want from the sample and size of that particular sample material. So based upon nature of information that you can obtain from sample, it is classified into four types. So we will see one by one. So very first one is called as proximate analysis. Okay, so what is the meaning of that? It involves the determination of elemental composition of the sample irrespective of the chemical form in which element are present. So it is quite simple type of analysis in which you have to just find out the elemental composition of your sample. For example, coal is found abundant in nature, right? And it is used as source of energy. So if you perform the proximate analysis of coal, it will tell you about the parameters like its moisture content, volatile component, ash content, and fixed carbon, etc. So this is called as proximate analysis. Now suppose you want some more extent of analysis, then you have to perform the second type, that is partial analysis. In this, only one component of the sample is determined in detail. So in last part, what we have done? You have done or you have estimated your sample very roughly. That is what are only element present that you have found out. But in this case, you have to find out a particular component but in detail form. So for example, in case of metallurgical analysis of a particular sample, the determination of metal content is confirmed. It presents an approximate amount of quantity. So whenever you perform analysis for a metal, you will find out a definite amount and then definite quality, means which metal is present. This type of analysis is called as partial analysis. Now suppose you want to go more detail, then you have to perform trace analysis. So it is specialized form of partial analysis. It is used to detect or quantify trace, that is very small amount of substance present in the sample. So this type of analysis generally used to determine impurity in given sample. So as we all know, the main components are in more amount of form, but the impurities present in your sample are in very small amount. So suppose you want to find out the impurities present in your sample, you have to perform trace analysis, right? So what is the example? Testing of residual solvent in pharmaceutical tablet. Whenever you make the pharmaceutical tablet, in the last session you get some residual solvent. So what amount of solvent is remaining, that you can find out using trace analysis. Now the fourth method or fourth type is complete analysis. So as the name suggests, it refers to one in which detailed information about the sample is obtained, right? So whatever all earlier part you have performed, all part you have to perform in complete analysis. This is a complete report about the concluded and collaborative data about the sample with the data of all above analysis. So when you perform complete analysis, means you have to follow all the above methods in your experiment. Now we will see the second type, that is based upon the size of sample used in your analysis. Then the different types are micro analysis, semi micro analysis, and micro analysis. So in macro analysis, it is the analysis in which the size of sample is more than 100 milligram, that is in between 0.1 gram or more than 100 microliter. So suppose you are using liquid, it should be more than 100 microliter, that is 0.1 ml. The second type is semi-micro analysis. So it is the one in which your sample size is between 10 milligram to 100 milligram, that is 0.01 to 0.1 gram of sample. And in terms of volume, it should be between 50 to 100 microliter, that is 0.05 to 0.1 ml. The third type is microanalysis. So it is the one in which the sample size is in between 1 to 10 milligram, that is 0.001 to 0.01 gram. And by volume, it is less than 50 microliter, that is 0.05 ml. So as all these terms explain, you can see that for microanalysis, very small amount of sample is present. So suppose you use your regular apparatus, it is not possible for us to determine the quantity or determine our required things. So what you have to do? For microanalysis, you have to use a special type of apparatus, and the determination is based on crystal structure formed by the analytic with the reagent. So what are now further type of methods that we will see in our next lecture? Thank you so much.